give the floor to Professor Dr. Willem Lems.
Thank you for the introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure for me to speak here about glucocorticoid-induced osteoporosis. Before that, I have a special thank for the organizers, Zeus Makatos, Professor Papapoulos and Natasha Appelman for organizing me and inviting me and organizing such an interesting meeting. This is, we start with a view on the Parthenon on the top of the Acropolis during full moon, as it was yesterday evening, a view from the Dionysus restaurant, and on the right side you see Amsterdam, the canals, which doesn't look so very interesting, but I can promise you, suppose we have a second meeting in Amsterdam, it will be better than on the right side. So these are my disclosures. So these are the typical issues that we are going to discuss about glucocorticoids. And we start with secondary osteoporosis, let's say, effect. I suppose every disease will in the end lead to secondary osteoporosis because of inflammation, malnutrition, immobility, and so on. But glucocorticoids are by far the most often cause of secondary osteoporosis. So that's one point. And the other point is glucocorticoid-induced osteoporosis important according to physicians and to patients? This has been investigated by the European rheumatologist, the EULAR, asking patients and questions about the ranking of side effects, and osteoporosis was on the top three, or even on the top two, according to patients and physicians. Glucocorticoids are very effective, as you all know, are probably one of the most effective and rapidly working immunosuppressive drugs, but it has also a lot of side effects, and osteoporosis is one of the most important because it's irreversible. A lot of people are looking for developing better drugs with the same efficacy and less side effects, but it's not so simple, and it's also not so simple to find a sponsor for doing this. In general, the idea is that we should treat our patients with glucocorticoids with the lowest possible dosage and as short as possible, but in daily practice that's sometimes different. This is from patients with rheumatoid arthritis. In 1996, more than 50% of patients with rheumatoid arthritis are using glucocorticoids, and in 2013 it's still 50% are treated with glucocorticoids. But in 2013, only 5% are using high-dose glucocorticoids. How often do we use glucocorticoids in another disease, in SLE? My co-worker Irene Bulting has looked at it in an observational study in more than 100 patients with SLE, so it's a very large study, and she found out that more than 70% of the patients uses prednisone and 10% uses IV methylprednisolone. This is a study from the Ramsey Goldman cohort, Pittsburgh, an important cohort in patients with SLE, looking through glucocorticoids and fractures. The yellow line are individuals with SLE less than 5 years treated with prednisone, and the pink line more than 5 years prednisone, and it gives the suggestion that there are more fractures in patients with longer treatment duration, and that suggests that prednisone has a negative effect on fracture rates, which is actually true. But the difficulty with these kind of studies is, of course, that patients who are longer treated with prednisone usually have also more severe disease, and the disease activity is also one of the important components of the negative influence on bone. The dosage is very important. This is one of the largest studies I'm aware of. This is a study of 240,000 healthy controls versus 230,000 prednisone users, and you can see that the dosage of prednisone is related to hip fractures and also to spine fractures. So who are the patients who have the highest risk of fractures? That is, as you can see on this slide, and a focus on the women on the right part, that's patients who have a higher age and patients who are having higher dosage of prednisone. So preventive measures for the bone are particularly necessary in elderly patients, women treated with high-dose glucocorticoids. This is the Amsterdam scheme, which are the risk factors for osteoporosis and fractures in patients with rheumatic diseases, or in other words, with secondary osteoporosis. It's the what we call the background risk factors you're all aware of. That's high age, female gender, familial osteoporosis, low BMI, fall risk, and lifestyle. But additionally, there are also disease-related factors. You can see it here, high levels of inflammation, high levels of immobility, high dosages of glucocorticoids. And in patients with rheumatic disease, there are sometimes special situations, high risk for vitamin D deficiency in patients with SLE who have to avoid sunshine, and an elevated risk on vertebral fractures in patients with ankylosing spondylitis because of the rigidity of the spine. Majority of the audience will probably be aware of the FREX system, which is a good predictor for the future fracture risk over 10 years. You can fill in whether your patient has yes or no glucocorticoids, but the disadvantage is you cannot fill in the dosage of glucocorticoids, which is an important predictor of future fracture risk. One of the questions is always, what happens after stopping prednisone? Is the elevated fracture risk going to reduce? And the answer is yes. A relatively recent study observing patients after stopping prednisone. This is the end of the prednisone use, and you see over time there is a reduction of fracture risk after stopping prednisone, and with that probably also after the disease is under control with other drugs. What about the pathogenesis? I'm not going about it into too much detail. The pathogenesis is not fully elucidated. This is a slide from Weinstein from 2011. Recently, I added an S to that. And in patients with glucocorticoids, the main point is the reduction in bone formation. The osteoblastogenesis is decreased. There is increased apoptosis. So reduction in bone formation plays a central role. What about bone resorption? In the early phase, there is an increase in bone resorption, which has to do at least partly to intestinal lower calcium absorption and renal elevated calcium excretion. And in later phases, bone formation and bone resorption are coupled, and both are low. Finally, there is an effect on osteocytes. You can see it in the middle. There's an increased apoptosis of osteocytes. And in the end, there is decreased bone quality and an increased fracture risk in patients using glucocorticoids. And apart from the effect on the bone, there's also an effect on the muscles, leading to muscular weakness and maybe an elevated risk of falling. So what about treatment options in patients with glucocorticoids? This is a scheme, let's say the basic scheme, you should use the glucocorticoids at the lowest possible doses, but we have just seen that in the daily practice that's sometimes difficult. Adequate calcium and vitamin D is important, exercises. Optimal treatment of the underlying disease is very important, often forgotten, and stop smoking and limited alcohol intake is also important. And what are we doing in daily practice? Are we treating our patients with glucocorticoids optimal? And the answer is no. This is the GLOW study, an international cohort study, large number of cohorts. And you can see that the percentage of patients with calcium treated during glucocorticoids is 67%. Glucocorticoid users treated with vitamin D, 68%. And anti-osteoporotic drugs, bisphosphonate or something else, 42%. BMD testing in 65%. So we're not treating our patients with glucocorticoids optimal. Can we improve that? I show you one experiment from the Netherlands, an elegant experiment in patients treated with glucocorticoids for more than half a year. A trial designed by pharmacists. Half of the patients were the control group. That is this part. And the other part, there was an intervention by pharmacists. And in case there were no bisphosphonates prescribed, the pharmacists did a phone call or another contact with the physician discussing whether bisphosphonates should be started, yes or no. And these were the results of this randomized trial. A result which I quite often discuss with my students. can see in the black line the bisphosphonate users after the intervention of the pharmacist. The gray line is the control group that is statistically significant, but from my point of view, it's clinically not relevant. The bisphosphonate users in the control group was 9%, and after the intervention of the pharmacist, it was only 11%, so a very small gain after the intervention, and in my opinion, not clinically relevant. What are other options? Well, maybe several other options. One of the options is to use a drinkable formulation of alendronate. Probably it has the potential to increase the compliance, and there is, of course, much less irritation of the esophagus and the stomach. Coming back to the studies from earlier days in bisphosphonates, at that time versus placebo, we have two types of studies: glucocorticoid users who are starting glucocorticoids, and studies in which patients are on chronic use. Starters have usually a higher dosage and also usually a higher underlying disease activity. This is risedronate versus placebo, risedronate yellow, placebo red, and you see a favorable effect in BMD for risedronate, and in the placebo group, which was also treated with calcium and vitamin D, bone loss of around 3% in the spine and the femoral neck. Then the patients who are on chronic treatment, usually with a somewhat lower dosage of prednisone, and hopefully patients are under control or in remission, you see the same favorable effect of risedronate versus placebo, but in the placebo group, hardly any bone loss after a year of treatment. But these patients have also had calcium and vitamin D. Probably your question is, what about fractures? This is a slide comparing the effect of oral bisphosphonates in postmenopausal women and in glucocorticoid users. Let's focus on the left side. On the vertebral fractures, these are the relative risks, roughly 0.50 for postmenopausal women and for glucocorticoid users, both statistically significant. For non-vertebral fractures, the fracture reduction is lower, roughly about 20%, but that's statistically significant in the postmenopausal women and not statistically significant anymore in the GOP users, probably related to a lower number of patients. What about the more modern studies? The more modern studies are not for ethical reasons versus placebo, but versus an active comparator, and that's very important, of course, for the interpretation. First one, zoledronic acid versus risedronate, and you can see that zoledronic acid is superior in terms of BMD versus risedronate at all sites, the lumbar spine and at the hip. No fracture data, but remember, it was an active comparator. Second one, teriparatide, 3-year studies versus alendronate from Ken Sage and others. And you see here a reduction in vertebral fractures after 18 months. This is the blue bar is the alendronate group. This is teriparatide. Are the 36 months also a statistically significant and probably clinically relevant decrease in vertebral fractures? No difference in non-vertebral fractures. And for those of you who like to see slides on bone mineral density, you see a comparator larger increase in the teriparatide group than in the bisphosphonate group. It's important to realize that glucocorticoid-induced osteoporosis is predominantly a disease in which bone formation is reduced. So from the pathogenesis point of view, it's very logical to start with an anabolic drug such as teriparatide in glucocorticoid users. So we have two drugs which have a superior effect on the oral bisphosphonates, zoledronic acid and teriparatide, and maybe we have also favorable effect on denosumab, but I'll show you that later. We have also some slides on this. This is glucocorticoids in men. Again, teriparatide versus risedronate. We see favorable effects on the QCT that has been discussed by Bert van Rietbergen this morning. Several favorable effects on components of bone strength, particularly on the trabecular sides. But this is an interesting study showing also an effect on P1 and P. I discussed that more in detail with you. Here you see the changes in P1 and P, a marker of bone formation, and the bone strength measured by final element analysis. You see the green circles, that's the teriparatide group. This is the resilient group, and you can see that there's a clear association between the increase in P and P1 and the increase in bone strength, suggesting that measuring P1 and P is a good marker for your patients to find out whether there is a good treatment response, yes or no. And that's not the situation for risedronate, no statistically significant association. This is after 18 months, but earlier after 6 months, and even after 3 months, you can find that statistically significant association. So maybe measuring P1 and P is an attractive option for your patients. What about the third new second-line drug, that's denosumab? We have now also done a study in glucocorticoid users, observing the effect of denosumab versus risedronate. Again, a study in two parts, the glucocorticoid continuing group, patients who are on long-term treatment of glucocorticoids and the starters, all patients with at least 7.5 milligram prednisone per day, double dummy study, so patients get two injections of denosumab and once daily risedronate placebo, or the other way around, once daily risedronate or two placebo injections with denosumab during a period of 2 years, all patients treated with calcium vitamin D. These are the results on the lumbar spine after 6 and 12 months. You see a favorable effect in both groups, in the continuing group and in the starters. And as expected, the treatment response is somewhat larger in the patients who are continuing the glucocorticoids for a longer period of time, probably because of lower dosages and lower disease activity. The same pattern can be found in the hip. Also a favorable effect of denosumab versus risedronate in terms of BMD. And the next question is, of course, what happens with the bone markers? A larger decrease in CTX and P1 and P in the denosumab group versus the risedronate group. What about fractures? There's no reduction in fracture. The epidemiologists say, well, the study was not powered for it. You can also express it in other words. This was a large study in glucocorticoid users, but it has only 700 patients. And in the pivotal trial, it was more than 7,000 patients. Another point was this was a study with an active comparator. Well, in the FREEDOM study, it was versus placebo. So that's probably, in my opinion, the reason for the fact that we don't find any reduction in fractures. Then an important point is the relationship is more complex between glucocorticoids and rheumatoid arthritis, and probably also for other diseases than thought at first sight. Glucocorticoids have a negative effect on the bone. The disease activity of rheumatoid arthritis and probably of all other diseases of secondary osteoporosis have a negative effect on bone strength, but glucocorticoids reduce the disease activity of RA, and that may have a positive effect on bone. I'm not going to discuss that too much in detail, but just one example, study from Utrecht, from the Netherlands, in which patients with rheumatoid arthritis are treated with methotrexate, both arms, and one arm is also treated with 10 milligram prednisone per day, and you see no difference in BMD of the lumbar spine and hip. I must say, patients were treated with calcium and vitamin D at the discretion of the rheumatologist, and if there was an indication, they have had bisphosphonates. So in this situation, there's no bone loss in patients with rheumatoid arthritis treated 2 years with prednisone 10 milligram per day, which is quite remarkable and is strongly related to the fact that a large number of patients were in clinical remission with antirheumatic drugs. So what about the guidelines? Is there consistency in the guidelines? Well, the answer is no. Let's say, what is the dosage above which you should prescribe anti-osteoporotic drugs? Let's focus on the American College of Rheumatology. They say, well, above 7.5 milligram per day, you should prescribe anti osteoporotic drugs. The National Osteoporosis Foundation, also US, above 5 milligram. The Royal College of Physicians say all patients who are treated at least 3 months and have a dosage and are above 65 years, and the Belgian Bone Club, above 9.3 milligram per day, you should prescribe anti-osteoporotic drugs, a curious threshold. But nevertheless, it's clearly that it's different between the groups. And what's the threshold in BMD above which you should treat your patients? According to the American College of Rheumatology, it's depending on the FREX, National Osteoporosis Foundation, below minus 2.5, here minus 1.5, and here minus 1 or minus 1.5. So clearly it's different between large organizations who are producing guidelines in the GEOP. Nevertheless, there's also some consensus, and that's on one other point. We have the Dutch guideline, we are updating it now, but the idea is, and that's, I suppose, in all guidelines, that if you have a patient with a high risk, for instance here, a high dose prednisone or a fracture, you should start with a bisphosphonate as soon as possible. And if your patient with a low dose or intermediate dose, you should, before starting with a bisphosphonate, firstly do a DEXA or VFA to calculate the risk, whether it's necessary to prescribe an oral bisphosphonate. And in fact, that's the same in other guidelines. Here you see the ECTS IOF, the same pattern. In patients with high risk, it's treatment with bisphosphonates, and here high risk is defined as age above 70 or a high dose prednisone. In other patients, you should firstly do a FREX or BMD to get more insight of the risk of your patients and make then treatment decisions. What about the American College of Rheumatology guideline? The same pattern, although I must say it's again a complex guideline. Here you see the high-risk group. I'm not going to discuss it in detail, but the high-risk should start with bisphosphonates as soon as possible. And it is the other group is the low-risk group. Here's something very special. Take your attention. What kind of drugs should you prescribe according to the American College of Rheumatologists, which is in the field of rheumatology an important player? The first step is oral bisphosphonate, but the second line is IV bisphosphonate. The third line is teriparatide, and the fourth line is denosumab, in that order. So that's quite remarkable. So we just published a paper in Drugs about how to treat patients with glucocorticoids with some co-workers from Amsterdam, and it's largely comparable with earlier guidelines. Lifestyle is important, adequate calcium, vitamin D, exercise therapy, and so on. First line, start with alendronate or resedronate. Second line, zoledronic acid or denosumab or teriparatide in patients who fracture during first line therapy or don't tolerate it. But this is something new. It's probably a good idea, a good suggestion that physicians start initially with these second-line drugs, one of these second-line drugs, in patients with a very high-risk initial therapy. It's important to remember patients, we're discussing patients who do not have postmenopausal osteoporosis only. We're discussing patients who have also an underlying disease and who are treated with high-dose prednisone. And we think that it's a good suggestion that in these patients, we should start with second-line drug therapy, any of the second-line drug therapy, because we have evidence, I've shown it to you, that all three drugs are superior to oral bisphosphonates. So these are the conclusions. Glucocorticoid-induced osteoporosis, the most common type of secondary osteoporosis, and inhibition of bone formation plays an important role. Fracture risk is dependent on the dosage and on the underlying disease. Prevention, calcium, vitamin D. Oral bisphosphonates are first line, but the second line is also important. The thresholds differ between the different guidelines, but starting with oral bisphosphonates in high-risk patients is advocated in all guidelines, and we suggest that starting with second-line drugs in patients with a very, very high risk is also an attractive option. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Willem, for this very nice overview. Questions from the audience? If not yet, May I ask a question, or do you? Yeah. Or I don't miss anything right now. You told the perfect. You discussed what could be the good, the right decision to start treatment, like the first line, the second line, and now we have all those alternatives. But actually, you showed in the beginning that there is actually a very big problem that's only a very small part of the people that should be treated are indeed treated. So wouldn't that be a thing that we should address, and how are we going to do that?
Let's say that's the question, which is a serious problem for many years. How to increase awareness for the effects of glucocorticoids on bone among patients and GPs and so on, which is always difficult, because in writing guidelines it's very simple that you should start with the bisphosphonates in the patient who is starting with glucocorticoids. But in daily practice, in my practice and in your practice, it's a patient with rheumatoid arthritis who wants to know everything about his underlying disease, and then you say, well, you need to have some prednisone, and by the way, you need also calcium, vitamin D, and have also a bisphosphonate. So in daily practice, it's still difficult. That's one of the reasons it's lower than it should be. Yes.
Thank you for your talk. I was wondering, you say that you might start with second-line therapy in patients with very high fracture risk, but how would you define that? If they have previous fractures or very low T-scores, what would you say?
That's of course, a very important point. Let's say finding a consensus on what is a high fracture risk is difficult over the years. We have had a discussion yesterday, even for postmenopausal women. It's a discussion what is the best threshold, or how to define a very high fracture risk patient before initiating with anabolic or probably expensive therapy. I think it's good that we make just this point, that experienced physicians can make their own choices what is a high fracture risk. And from my personal view, that's patients with a high age, with a low BND, and with a vertebral fracture.
Thanks, Willem, for this wonderful overview. I have a question you probably won't have an answer. It's something I'm struggling with in the clinical practice. It's the patients that have been using glucocorticoids for a very long time, for over 10 years. They have high risk, low BMD, have had in the past vertebral fractures. Maybe they have had a course of teriparatide. What would you advise? Would you continue with bisphosphonates even after 10 years?
Yeah, that's of course a difficult question because of the risk of atypical fractures. On the other hand, patients who have on glucocorticoids for many years usually have a lower dosage, and the resistivity is under control. So it may be not too risky to stop. And the other point is, of course, as rheumatologists, we have so many drugs at the moment that it's usually nearly always possible to stop the prednisone if it's really necessary, because we have so much alternatives. Yeah. But that's not always the case.
Yeah, thank you.
You said that there is a superiority of oral bisphosphonate against alternative treatment with teriparatide or denosumab for vertebral fracture. Is that true for non-vertebral fracture?
No, the effects from the fracture reduction for vertebral fractures is around 50%, and for non-vertebral fractures it's much smaller, so that's the difficulty. But also something to do with the fact that the studies in glucocorticoid users are smaller than in postmenopausal women. So.
Thank you very much. I think there are no further questions.